about distractions. And speaking of distractions, can anybody raise your hand if you were here last Sunday? If you were here last Sunday, let me see your hand. All right, so a good portion of y'all. Now, let me ask you this. Do y'all remember when my dad said something along the lines of he wore a pink tutu this one time and he didn't want the picture to resurface? Well, it is my great pleasure and my duty as his son to show you guys this picture. Yes, it was sent to me by an anonymous source. Y'all just take a good look at that. That's not Photoshop. That's before the days of Photoshop, okay? Good times. So here's what I want y'all to do, since we're on the topic of distractions. This is a huge distraction right now, right? I need y'all to, everyone, take your phone out and just take a picture of that, please. And if you want to take it a step further, go ahead and post it on Facebook and tag Circle J Cowboy Church just to see what happens, because he has no idea that I have this picture. He has no idea I'm doing this right now. He thinks I'm preaching. No. So do me a favor. Take a picture of that. Keep it forever. Send it to all your friends. And most importantly, please post it on Facebook and tag Circle J Cowboy Church. Please. I would love for him to get 1,000 notifications right now while he's sitting in another church. His phone's going. Because y'all are reposting that. Please do that. He may hold a grudge on this one. That's all right. I'm willing to suffer the consequences. But anyways, now that we've gotten that distraction out of the way, let's pray and then we'll jump into the message. Lord, I just thank you for everybody's here. I thank you for this opportunity to speak and to pour into the hearts of this congregation. Lord, I do pray that it would be you speaking today and not me. And I do pray that as we go through this message and as we've gone through this series, that we would realize what's truly important, that is you, Lord. I pray that by the end of this message, everyone in here would have something that they can lay down to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so before we get started, hopefully everyone in here got a little bitty note card and a pen or something like that. So here's what I want you to do. If you don't have one of these, can you please raise your hand so that one of the ushers can come around and give you something? If you don't have one, ushers are going to come around and give you one of these note cards. But if you do have one and you have something to write with, here's what I want you to do before we start anything out. Is here, since we're talking about distractions, okay, I want to give you a second to write down the most important things to you in the world on this note card. Okay, and that can be absolutely anything. But here's the deal. I want you to write down the stuff that you feel like you couldn't live without. That can be people. That can be things, okay? That can be a crazy amount of stuff, okay? I'll give you just some examples. It can be stuff like family, friends, hobbies, sports, hunting or fishing. It could be things like four-wheelers or trucks or guns or your job or, oh, my goodness, dare I say it, your phone? Ooh, who said that? So if you love it and you feel like you couldn't live without it, you use it every day, you're all about it, please just write that down on your note card. Just do that real quick, and I'll give you just a second to do that, and then we'll move on. So if you love it, write it down. And as you're writing them down, if you got some, y'all can go ahead and shout some out. Because let me tell you something. I like some feedback. I like y'all to talk to me while I'm up here. Because I get nervous if y'all all just stare at me like I'm looking really weird. And I start to wonder, is one of my buttons undone or something? So go ahead and shout some of them out. What are you writing down? Okay, keep going. Who else? Electricity. Excellent. Absolutely. Anybody else got something they want to shout out? Okay. All right, so y'all all got your stuff written down for the most part? All right, good. Now just hang on to that note card, and we'll get to that in just a second. So the thing is, though, all those things that you shouted out, and chances are all the things that you're writing down, are all good things, right? Nobody shouted crack cocaine, right? I didn't miss that, did I? Okay, good, because if somebody did, we might want to talk afterwards, right? But so they're all good things, right? All right, and that's my point. But what if, though, the good things in our life were keeping us from the great things in life? So, got a question for you guys. You know, if you know me, you know whenever I preach, I like to ask questions, and I like some feedback. But I've got a question. Does anybody want $20 a day? Okay, like, I'm dead serious. Like, if you want it, you can have it. Like, it, Who wants $20? I'm walking down here, and someone wants it. You can have it. Okay, I'm just going to say this. If you really want $20, you're not just sitting there like, if you want it, come and get it. I'm serious. Okay, but before I give it to you, let me ask you this. Do you still want this $20 even if it means that you can't have something else? I'm not going to tell you what it is, but just know, if you take this $20, it's yours. If you try to give it back to me after church, I won't take it back. It is your $20, no questions asked. Do you want it? I can't tell you that.
Yeah, I want it.
Okay, it's yours. Okay, thank you. Y'all give her a round of applause. She was faster than all y'all. I mean, if you really wanted $20, you'd have stood up and got it. Okay, so, but here's the deal. So, what if I told you, though, well, let me ask you this first. Are you happy with that $20 bill? Okay, I'd be happy if I walked out of here with $20 more than I walked in. I mean, that's just me. But let me ask you this. What if I told you, though, since you took that $20, now you can't have this $100 bill? You see, I should be a game show host, actually. That's my second calling one of these days, right? Are you upset? You're not upset? Not even if I was to trade you right now, would you trade? Okay. I figured. I mean, if not, you're crazy. But here's the deal. You may not realize it, and it's not just you. This is all of us. I'm talking to all of us now. All right, we may not realize it, but that's exactly what we're doing every single day in our lives. We've been trading $20, trading, getting rid of this $100 bill for a $20 bill our whole life. And we're happy. We go, oh my goodness, I got a $20 bill. This is awesome. But how much more awesome would it be with a $100 bill? And so I use that illustration because everybody gets money. Everybody knows that money's important. Everybody wants more money. But that's why we're talking about today's message, and it's titled Good versus Great. So before we get into today's scripture, and if you know me, I don't preach without talking about scripture because there's something I like to say. Ty's words will never change people's hearts, never ever, no matter how good I speak, but God's words always will, okay? Let me ask you something, though, before we get into the scripture today. Would you rather have $20 or $100? Answer, shout it out. Okay, fair, safe assumption to say everyone in here would rather have the $100 bills. Okay, let me ask another question to you guys. Do you want good things in your life, or would you rather have great things in your life? Can we all agree on that, that we would rather have great things than good things? What about this? Let me ask another question. Would you be willing to give up some good things, i.e. a $20 bill, for some great things in your life? Can we all agree on that? All right, perfect. Well, then y'all are all ready to hear the scripture then. All right, so we're going to look at Exodus 20, verse 3, first off. It's actually up on the screen for you guys. And it's actually the first verse that I want to look at is actually the first of the Ten Commandments. So let's go ahead and read it, short, sweet, and to the point. It says, "You shall have no other gods before me." Boom. Okay, so this is the point where some of you are looking at me and going, okay, well, that's cool and all, Ty, but what does that have to do with good versus great? Okay, well, that's an excellent question. I'd like to explain that. So just like that $20 bill, some of the things in your life are keeping you from the great things. So at this point, I think it's time for me to explain what it means to be a good thing versus a great thing. So let me explain this. Good things are probably all the things that you wrote down on your note card, right? Okay. Now, great things, on the other hand, are anything that have to do with God and the blessings that come from serving God. Okay, can I say that again? Great things are anything to do with God and the blessings that come from serving God. Okay? And so, you see, the truth is, whether you realize it or not, whether you're living in it or not, everyone in this room was created for one purpose. Does anybody know what that purpose is? To serve God. Period, point blank. That's it. That's the reason you were made. That's the reason you're sitting in that chair today. Whether you realize it, whether you admit it or not, we were created with a purpose, and that was to serve God. And the thing is, if you don't live in your purpose, you can never have joy in your life. You see, you can be happy, right? But you'll never have joy. You ask me how I know. I'd love for y'all to ask me after service how I understand this and how I've come to this conclusion. But let me explain the difference between happiness and joy. Happiness Happiness is based on surroundings and situations. I can be happy right now, right? And if one of y'all runs up the stage and charges me and punches me in the face, please don't do that. I'm not going to be happy anymore, okay? In fact, I'm probably going to be pretty mad. Like, why did you hit me? Did I say something that offended you? Right? But I can still have joy in that circumstance, because joy is not affected by anything around you. Joy comes from within, and the only way that we find joy is from serving God, from living in our purpose. And so, when that verse says, no other gods before me, he says, you shall have no other gods before me. This is God speaking to you. He says this, if you're like me, okay, you're thinking, oh, well, that's like Old Testament stuff. And like, you know, he's talking about making those wood gods and those golden idols and all that stuff like that. Okay. And you're like, you know what? I'm good. I don't have any of those. Okay. But the reality today, and this is one of those things that if you take notes, you probably want to write this down. I'll say it a couple times for you in case you're ready. Okay. But it says the reality today is something, is anything that we put more time and effort into getting closer to God, into then getting closer to God, can, if we're not careful, become a god. Does that make sense? Anything that you spend more time, more effort, more money, more resources on than you would getting closer to God, if you're not careful, it will become a little g god in your life. And that's so true, but I say that to prove to you this verse is very relevant today, because we have a million different things. And I'll tell you guys, I am as guilty as anybody else. This thing right here, your cell phone, love them to death. They're great things. But man, I have been definitely guilty of getting distracted by one of these. So, I'll tell you this, in fact, Scripture even speaks to that. It goes on to illustrate more in Romans 12, verse 1 is the next scripture we're going to look at. It says this. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. So question, this is where you talk. This is the part where you talk. We're supposed to set aside what? Two things. They're highlighted. I'm trying to help you out. See, I want you guys to have every chance to succeed. I'm not trying to make you fail. All right, perfect. Y'all got it. All right, we're supposed to lay aside every weight and every sin. So I think it's safe to say that we all know what a sin is, right? A sin is doing anything that goes against God's holy word. But does anybody in here understand what a weight is when he's talking about this? Can anybody say it? Shout it out if you know. It brings you down. What else? Doubt, that's a good one. Anybody else know what a weight is? Fear. All right, those are all good answers, okay? But the truth is, the broad answer for all this is a weight is anything that distracts you from God. So if you're taking notes, again, that would be a great thing to write down. A weight is anything that distracts you from God. And put that scripture, Romans 12, 1, right next to it, okay? So if we're honest, though, most of those good things that you wrote down on your note card earlier at the beginning of this message, chances are they may even be what would fall into the category of a weight. And that's a scary statement, because I promise you, if I'm shooting in a barrel, I was the first one who got hit, because I am the world's worst about getting distracted and letting things take over my life and getting distracted from my purpose and what I'm supposed to be doing. I am the biggest time waster in this entire room. If you let me, I'll spend the whole day doing nothing. I'll spend the whole next day doing nothing. And the day after that. So I promise I'm not just ragging on you guys. But most of those things that we wrote down, chances are they're exactly what's keeping us from going to the next level with God. Okay? But once we've set those things aside, does anybody know what we're supposed to do then? He goes on in verse 2 of Romans 12 to say this. He says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So he says this, once we've set aside these weights and these sins, we're supposed to look to Jesus. We're supposed to focus on him. Because he is the most important thing in your life. Period. Right now, tomorrow, yesterday, and the day after that, and forever. Jesus is the only thing that is truly important. You know why? Because he's the only thing that will make an eternal difference in your life. You can have all this stuff. You can have all these hobbies. You can have all these friends. But none of that matters on the day that you die. Jesus is the only one that makes an eternal difference. And so, to demonstrate what God is talking about in these verses here, I want you guys to really get this point. Stephen, I know I didn't tell you, but I'm calling you out. I need you to come down here, please. All right, we're going to have a good old-fashioned race, okay? But it's not going to be a fair race. And perhaps some of you are wondering why there was a stack of chairs up here in the front. Number one, because I widened the aisle, and I'm honestly scared that I might run into some of y'all. So if you're worried I might hit you, you might want to scoot over a chair if you're on the outside of it. Or at least put your feet inside of the aisle, hands and feet inside of the aisle to yourself, kind of like an airplane. Because we're fixing to have a rip-roaring race right down the center of this, and I'm watching you. You might want to watch out because we're coming straight for you. Okay, but I want to demonstrate this. Mr. Stephen here is in from the Air Force, and goodness gracious, it's like a rock. Goodness gracious. Stephen here is lean, mean, cut machine, okay? He has been working out. He's been running. He's fast. He was fast before he went to the Air Force. But I do think there was a genuine chance, possibly, that I could beat him in a flat-out race if I had the right shoes and he had the wrong shoes and all that good stuff, you know. But today we're going to have a race, and Stephen here is going to represent our Christian who has laid down his distractions and his weights. So, Stephen, what do you have on your back? Just a t-shirt, right? Pretty lightweight t-shirt, might I add, right? Well, me, on the other hand, unfortunately, I didn't listen to Ty's sermon, and I still am carrying around all my weights and my sins. And they're heavy, and they slow me down. And God said we're going to run a race. So, dadgummit, Stephen, we're going to run a race. Are you ready? Okay. So, I'm going to give you full disclosure. I'm going to give this absolutely everything I have. If I beat Stephen pulling these chairs, shame on you, Stephen. Okay? But I'm going to give it everything, Stephen. You don't hold anything back. Full sprint to the back of the room. Whoever makes it there first wins. Deal? All right. Let me set this mic down. And I honestly gave that everything I had, I promise you. And I don't know if you're paying attention or not, but that was what you would call a landslide victory. I lost that race. I think that's pretty clear to say. It wasn't even close, right? But you see, when we raced right there, I was at a clear disadvantage, right? Stephen's faster than me anyways. He's in the Air Force. He's running every day. He's in way better shape than I am. Right, to start with, but then you put, I don't know what those chairs weigh, probably a good 100 pounds or so running behind me that I've got to pull. All of a sudden, I've got a disadvantage. Now, let me ask you this. How much easier do you think that race would have been for me if I wasn't pulling all those chairs? It would have been a lot easier. I'm not saying I would have beat Stephen, but I would have at least had a chance. He wouldn't have at least got me by a landslide. But that's why I did that, to show you exactly what you're doing every day. You're trying to live your life for God, and you're dragging around a whole stack of chairs, and you're wondering why you're not doing as much as you wish you could. Dadgummit, you got a bunch of weight behind you. It's slowing you down. It's holding you back. Okay? And so it makes perfect sense why he said to let go of those things. God said very clearly that we're supposed to set these things aside and focus on Jesus. But I'll tell you this, the common temptation of man, of woman, of teenager, is to say this, but you don't understand how much I love that thing. Anybody ever heard that? Oh, I can't give that up. I love that. That's my favorite hobby. That's my favorite thing. I have to have this job so that I can pay for all this stuff that I have. What about this? Have you ever heard this? How about this? I'm too busy to commit more to church and to God. Yeah, heard that one before, right? So to which I would answer, you better be careful how you spend your time. Because maybe you've heard this, maybe you haven't. Time is the most precious resource you ever will have. You know why? Because it doesn't matter how rich you are or how poor you are, you have 24 hours in a day. And you can't get them back once you spend them. That's the truth. So the question is, what are you doing with your time? So, and I would also answer to those statements, it doesn't matter how much you love that thing, right? What truly matters is how much you love God. And if you love God, your actions will follow, because he says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. In fact, the Bible goes on to say in James 4:4, he says, you adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. So what he's saying, in not fancy terms, is this. You got to make a choice. He said, you got to make a choice. So let me ask you the same question that I've been asking this whole time. And if you've been paying attention, say it with me. Would you rather have $20 or $100? Which one? Shout it out. Okay? Now, let me ask this in a more real sense. And you can keep this one to yourself. This is between you and God. Would you rather have the world or would you rather have Jesus? It's easy to say, not easy to do. And I get that. So, the time has come for you to make a choice. And the choice is who or what will you serve with your time, and will you lay those distractions down? So the good versus the great. Now, some of you in here have fallen for the lie that all those things you wrote down at the beginning of this message are going to bring you satisfaction, that they're going to bring you happiness, and they're going to bring you fulfillment. But you're dead wrong. You see, God is the only thing that can truly satisfy you. Ask me how I know. I've tried it both ways. I promise you, God is the only thing that will ever truly satisfy you. You can have happiness for a moment with all these other things, but the only thing that lasts is God. And so, if you're here and you're unhappy and you have no joy in your life and you're wondering why in the world is it like this, okay, there's a hole deep inside that you're trying to fill, but it just really isn't working so far, I want to offer you guys the answer today. And it's simple to say, but not very simple to do, is lay down the good for the great and see what happens. Let me tell you a secret. You can only hold one at a time. You got to make a choice whether you want to hold the good or whether you want to hold the great. And so I promise you guys, coming from personal experience, it's worth it. It's absolutely worth it. Is it easy? No, not even close. But it's worth it to lay down the good for the great. So if y'all would, bow your heads and let's pray. And with every eye closed and every head bowed, I just want to talk to you for just a second and get real with you. If as I've been speaking today, God's put it on your heart that you don't even know him. And if I asked you the question, if you died today, would you go to heaven or hell? Do you have a definite answer? You see, God is calling you right now to lay down the good for the great. And if that's you right here and you've never done that, I want to give you an opportunity to change your life by saying a simple prayer and accepting him as your Lord and Savior. And if that's you, just repeat after me. Say, Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner. And Lord, I just pray that you would come into my life, See, I've been living for the good, but from now on, I want to live for the great. Lord, I want you to be the boss of my life. I'm giving you control. I want you to come into me and fill me with your Holy Spirit. And I want to switch gears here for a minute and talk to you Christians with every head bowed and every eye closed. Can I just get you to be honest? And if you're here and you're letting the good things distract you from God, nobody's looking, could you just raise your hand up and let God know? Thank you. Thank you. I want to pray for you guys, a special prayer that God would give you the strength to sort out what's good and what's great in your life. And Lord, I pray that you would help them to lay down that good stuff, even though it's good, even though it's fun, even though it makes us happy. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to see that you are the only thing that is truly important in our lives. The only thing that will ever make an eternal difference is you. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to live like that, that you would give us the strength and the boldness to make a commitment to you today, to lay down the good things for the great. In Jesus' name, amen.